Penguin Random House Audio presents Mrs. Roosevelt's Confidante, a Maggie Hope mystery, by Susan Elia MacNeal. Read for you by Susan Duerden.
Southern Negro Speaks. I reckon they must have forgotten about me when I hear them say they're gonna save democracy. Funny thing about white folks wanting to go and fight way over in Europe for freedom and light. When right here in Alabama, Lord have mercy on me. They declare I'm a fifth columnist if I say the word free. Jim Crow all around me. Don't have the right to vote. Let's leave our neighbor's eye alone and look after our own moat. 'Cause I sure don't understand what the meaning can be when folks talk about freedom and Jim Crow me. Langston Hughes, 1941.
Prologue.
Franklin!
Eleanor Roosevelt demanded in high-pitched, warbling tones just short of dulcet.
Why didn't you tell me Winston Churchill's coming to the White House?
It was morning, and she opened the door of the president's bedroom without knocking. She stood next to the presidential flag, hands on hips, glaring. She was a slim, tall, middle-aged woman who seemed constantly in motion, except for rare moments such as this. Her thick grey hair was pulled into a low chignon. She was already dressed for the day, wearing a simple suit and low-heeled shoes. A triple strand of pearls encircled her neck. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, armed with newspapers, mail and messages, was taking breakfast in his narrow white hospital bed. The room was furnished with a heavy dark wardrobe, a mahogany bureau, and an old-fashioned rocking chair. On the walls were watercolour paintings of clipper ships, an oil portrait of Isaac Roosevelt, and a framed certificate of his membership in the New York Marine Society. The ornate Victorian fireplace was carved with vines and grapes and showcased a collection of miniature pigs, as well as silver-framed photographs. A stocking with the name Fowler, embroidered and trimmed with golden bells, hung from the mantel. The president was recovering from a sinus infection, and his usually clear eyes were ringed and red. The morning headlines for December the 22nd, 1941, were far from reassuring. 80 Japanese transports appear off Luzon. U.S. sank or damaged 14 U-boats in Atlantic. And Hitler ousts army head, seizes full control. Not to mention the continuing fallout from the attack on Pearl Harbor 15 days earlier. In papers around the nation, there was speculation about a Japanese attack on San Francisco, fears of a Japanese terrorist attack with suicide agents in Washington, D.C., and rumors of Nazi U-boats patrolling the East Coast with an eye on Montauk, Long Island, and Boston. And there was news about citizens of Japan living in the United States arrested under the Enemy Alien Act and sent to immigration detention centers. The true and staggering amount of devastation the Japanese attack at Pearl Harbor had wrought on the U.S. Navy was still not being reported to the newspapers, and so was still unknown by the average Joe, who heard only about a heavy loss of ships and planes and a death list that remained incomplete. Fowler, the Roosevelt's small black Scottish terrier, was also taking breakfast in bed. The curled-up dog accepted the tiny pieces of bacon the president fed to him. Behind Roosevelt and the most famous dog in the land was a shelf with a half-finished model ship, various medicine bottles, nose drops, bits of paper, pencil stubs, a stack of books, an ashtray full of cigarette butts, and three telephones. Outside, fog obscured the dying rose garden. At 59, Franklin Roosevelt was a tall, robust man, except for his legs, which were paralyzed by polio. He had a large, oblong face with a jutting jaw and silver pince-nez spectacles balanced on the bridge of his nose. He kept his Camel cigarette in an ivory holder between his teeth. In public, he always held it up at a jaunty angle, but in private, the angle of his cigarette holder gave away his mood, much like Fowler's tail gave away his. This morning, the president's cigarette hung loosely in his mouth, pointing to the floor. The president wiped at his nose with a monogrammed linen handkerchief. He'd known the British PM was coming ever since the attack on Pearl Harbor, but for security reasons had kept the news to himself.
Wow. One of the first things we must do is remove all the art depicting the War of 1812, said Mrs. Roosevelt. Keeping those paintings up would be a horrible gaffe.
The president reached down to stroke Valor's spiky ears.
Yes, dear.
As the dog wagged his tail, hoping for more bacon, Roosevelt sneezed.
Oh, spinach, he exclaimed. I can't shake this lousy cold.
Bless you.
The First Lady entered, long arms folded across her chest.
I think we can keep the Revolutionary War paintings, but perhaps take down George Washington.
President Washington, the president echoed, giving a good blow. Keep him up. Churchill has high respect for the Founding Fathers, so I've read. And even if he doesn't, Washington's still our first president. As the British learned in 1776, and the Axis powers will discover soon, the American spirit is indomitable.
Franklin looked at Eleanor over the wire rims of his spectacles.
The Prime Minister's a guest, yes, and now our ally. But we're going to be negotiating quite a few things while he's here, including the fate of the British colonies. Might not be a bad idea to remind him who won the Revolutionary War.
He slipped another morsel of bacon to Fowler, who wagged his tail in appreciation.
But why didn't you tell me earlier, Franklin? And I can't find Mrs. Nesbit anywhere. What are we going to serve on such short notice? She's a mediocre enough cook as it is. If only I'd known.
There was the heavy drumbeat of footsteps, then a knock at the open door. It was the president's chief butler, Alonzo Fields, a dignified colored man, well over 6 feet tall and nearly 300 pounds. Roosevelt noticed him waiting at the door and lowered the emotional temperature.
Now, Eleanor, all that little woman would do, even if she were here, is to tell Fields what we can tell him ourselves right now.
He looked to his butler.
Fields, have your staff prepare bedrooms for the Prime Minister and his party. And if you see Mrs. Nesbit, tell her to find Mrs. Roosevelt at once. We'll need dinner for 20 at 8, 9 at the latest. Yes, sir.
Eleanor blinked.
My word, Franklin. I don't think you realize how much work a visit from a foreign dignitary takes. And even with Tommy on Christmas vacation, Blanche didn't show up for work today. She didn't even call. It's not like her.
Malvina Tommy Thompson was the secretary who usually took dictation for the First Lady's My Day newspaper columns. Blanche Balfour had been brought in to temporarily replace her.
I'm sure Blanche is fine. And let the staff take care of everything. It's their job.
Fields had waited.
Anything else, sir? Ma'am?
Thank you, that's all, said the president.
Fields left, his tread heavy on the hall floor. But Eleanor was still fretting.
As First Lady, it all reflects on me, you know. And in addition to my column, I have a press conference today.
She began to pace at the foot of the bed, from one end of the worn Persian rug to the other.
I know you'll do a bang-up job, Babs.
His use of her nickname softened her edge a bit. The president kept his eyes on his newspaper, but the First Lady would not be put off.
And Franklin?
She stopped pacing to look at him. Already a statuesque woman, she towered over the man sitting up in bed.
Have you had a chance to read my letter to the governor of Virginia regarding the impending execution of Wendell Carton?
The president sighed.
If you haven't noticed, dear, we're at war. I have more on my plate with the Japs and the Huns than I know what to do with. And now with Winston coming.
A man's life is at stake.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president, but Eleanor Roosevelt was the matriarch of the family and a political powerhouse in her own right. Not only was she the president's eyes and ears for places his wheelchair couldn't take him, but she exerted a moral influence of her own.
I know.
Roosevelt looked up at his wife.
But I can't rile up those boys from Dixie right now, just as we're entering this war. We all need to pull together to win, North and South. I can't afford to antagonize a nation that only recently wanted to throw me out of office and elect an isolationist. Shouldn't your together include men like Wendell Carton? What about the Negroes?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.